Warm welcome and thank you to everyone for taking the time tonight to join our program. I'm happy we're able to host John McNiff tonight for his talk, Roger Williams, New and Dangerous, as part of our programming theme for the year, Taking a Stand in Rhode Island. And I would like to turn over to our executive director, Dr. Morgan Graff, to introduce John. And is the connection doing well? Okay, great, thank you.
Thank you, Geraldine. Hopefully everybody can hear me. I'm delighted to see all of you here tonight, and I'm even more delighted to welcome my friend John McNiff back to our stage. He has been a huge part of the Rhode Island Historical Society for many years, and so we are always so happy to have him with us. John is born and raised in Rhode Island, went to Rhode Island College, but actually continued his education, not just here in Rhode Island, but also in England, where he spent a lot of his time literally digging into the fields of anthropology and archaeology. And he pursued that while at the same time also doing things like sales and advertising and actually going to become a commercial fisherman for a time. So his past is vast and varied, and you'll see those threads that crop up in the stories that he tells and in the way this has shaped his career. Many of us know John much more, not from archaeology, but more from his work as a reenactor, which is often influenced in Rhode Island maritime history, privateers and pirates. We see that commercial fisherman coming back, but also through his work as a park ranger at the Roger Williams National Memorial. We are always so pleased to partner with the National Memorial and to partner with a master storyteller like John. And he is here tonight to talk about one of our favorite topics, and that is Roger Williams. There's no one better to entertain us and regale us with these stories. So please join me in heartily welcoming John McNiff back to our Zoom stage.
I guess that's my cue. Hi there, everyone. Can everyone hear me? I know it's right now I'm getting a message that my internet connection is unstable, but anyway, I'm going to be talking about Roger Williams tonight, and many of you have probably heard me talk about Roger Williams before. But tonight I'm going to do something different. I'm going to do something that people say you should never do in polite society. I'm going to talk about religion and politics. It's going to be a little bit disruptive, but please do not take any of it personally. This is about Roger Williams. Title of this is New and Dangerous. So let's start from the very beginning. What do you call the function of your government? What do you call someone who wants to abandon the very framework that society is built upon? What do you call someone that points out religious hypocrisy in all its forms? And what do you call someone that wants to create a new type of society that gives political power to those that have never had it before, recognizes the right of people to believe what they want to believe, and recognizes those same rights of an apparently hostile potential enemy people, and wants to deal and treat with them as if they were equals? To understand Roger's story, you have to go all the way back. You have to go back before Roger was born to the England of Henry VIII. Now, we all know Henry VIII, six wives, divorced, beheaded, died, divorced, beheaded, survived. But Henry VIII took an England that was part of this entire Roman Catholic Church. Everyone in England belonged to the Roman Catholic Church. As a matter of fact, most people in Europe belonged to the Roman Catholic Church until an annoying thing happened in the early part of the 1400s. There was a huge technological improvement, a huge leap in information. This little thing called the printing press allowed things to be published, allowed ideas to be dispersed among people. And it's one of the reasons for the Protestant Reformation in Europe. People were able to read the Bible in their own language. People were saying, it doesn't say that in here, what those priests are telling us. And it started this huge turmoil. Now, that wasn't Henry's reason to separate from the Roman Catholic Church. He had other reasons. but he did, and established the Church of England with himself at the head. Henry. Now, everyone sees the money was distributed among Henry's friends. Everyone now in England, whether you wanted to or not, unless he was secretly a Roman Catholic, was a member of the Church of England. Then you have Edward, his son, when Henry dies, doesn't like the Church of England or the Roman Catholic Church, wants everybody to be Presbyterian. Everybody has to go through that process now. Edward's only on the throne for a short time. And Henry's daughter, Mary, becomes queen and wants everybody to go back to the Roman Catholic Church. Again, that process. It's not peaceful. It's not, oh, let's just change the labels on things. There's torture. There's imprisonment. There's martyrdom. Mary did so much that she got the nickname Bloody Mary. But she, when she died, Henry's other daughter, Elizabeth, who wants to be seen as a strong, independent woman, much like her father, Henry VIII, brings the Church of England back. Again, that process, persecution, turmoil. Other religious groups are popping up towards the end of Elizabeth's reign. And you have these group of people that want to fix the Anglican or the Church of England and purify it. They end up being called Puritans. When Elizabeth dies, her nephew, James VI of Scotland, comes down and becomes King of England, King James I. More turmoil, so much so that there's a plot to overthrow the government and install a Spanish princess as the new Queen of England. And this plot was to blow up the entire English government when they're sitting together, the royal family, the House of Lords, the House of Commons, in Parliament on November 5th, the Guy Fawkes, the gunpowder plot. Tremendous upheaval, religious turmoil, people are spying on each other. That's the world that Roger Williams is born into. And you also have to understand that religion had a tremendously strong role in society. Your religious beliefs, aside from what's written in the books, there was a tremendous amount of superstition going around at the same time. You're also dealing in England and in France with the divine right of kings, that they are God's appointed in this world. It's part of the great chain of being. It's a way of looking at the universe with God and his angels at the top, the kings, the emperors, and the nobility next, then the upper classes, the middle classes, the lower classes, then the flying animals and the walking animals and the crawling animals and the fish in the sea, and then even going into the dirt where you have really, really powerful dirt like diamonds, gold, silver, going down all the way to the very bottom of everything with this muck and sludge at the very bottom. Everything had its place in this great chain of being. And the king being so close to God at the very top of it, who is God's appointed to rule over you. And if you disobeyed the king, you were basically disobeying God. There's even something that was called the royal touch. If you were able to get the king to touch you, it would cure you of certain diseases. That's the kind of superstitions that were going around in people's minds. Religion, if something bad happened to you, if your crops failed, if your business failed, it's because you had done something wrong and displeased God. If you were a successful person, it's because you pleased God. All of this is rolling around in society, not to mention that with these various turmoil. Now, there were certain religious dissidents at the beginning of the 17th century, in the beginning of the 1600s, that felt because of this turmoil and the persecution that would come along with it, that they had to get out of England, go somewhere else, and have a fresh start. One group of them, in 1608, left England and went to the Netherlands, to Leiden, and set up shop there. They became successful to a degree. They were living a good life, but after about 10 years, they realized their children were not really English anymore. They were becoming Dutch. And they figured out another plan. There was one other place that they could go, all the way across the ocean to the New World. In 1620, This group of people that had been laden comes back to England and sets sail for the New World. We call them the Pilgrims. 2 months at sea, 2 months in cold weather, leaving in September and arriving here the end of November, beginning of December. Cold, wet, hungry. They come on shore and they start a small settlement that is now Plymouth. They survive for 10 years with passing fishermen and traders and things like that, bringing goods in. They're shipping goods back to try and pay off what they owe, because this is not so much a colony trying to recreate England. These are people trying to escape that persecution back in England. And as they did this by establishing a company. So now they have to pay back the money that they owe to that company with goods that they're harvesting in the New World, whether it's food or furs or something else. They're paying that back. After about 10 years of this, England, another group gets on 7 ships and leaves England. And in 1630, they come to the Massachusetts Bay. And they set up the towns of Boston and Salem. These are people that we call the Puritans under John Winthrop. Within a few months of their arrival in the New World, Roger Williams and his wife Mary arrive. It's February 1631. Think about what crossing the Atlantic on a ship very much like the Mayflower would have been like in the winter. There's no heating devices on board. It's cold. If you've ever done any sailing, you know that everything you own gets wet one way or another. That forms ice. You're constantly cold. And when they get here, there's not very much for them. But these Puritans were friends of Roger's. They all knew each other. They had associated back in England. So when Roger arrives as a goodly minister, he is offered the position of the minister in this new town of Boston. The difference between Boston and Plymouth was Boston had actually gotten a charter from the king. The king gave them this charter because they wanted to get rid of these troublemakers, give them a place to go that's far away and they won't bother us anymore. It had a sense of government in and of itself that they could decide what they were going to be doing. This was not a company that is sending back goods for profit for the company back in England. But that charter was from the king. And because that charter was from the king, the head of the Church of England, many of the people in this place called Boston would still at least nominally attend Church of England services, or at least when they went back to England, would attend Church of England services. When Williams was offered to be their minister, he said he couldn't. He could not, in good conscience, minister to, as he says, an unseparated people. Remember what they had done. They had left their homes, gone all the way across this ocean, a 2-month sea voyage, to come here to escape the turmoil and the persecution back in England. But now they're reestablishing the exact same environment that caused that persecution. After he refused the offer to be the minister in Boston, he went up to Salem, which was a little bit more liberal, and he became the assistant to the minister there. Boston warned Salem not to do this, not to let Roger do this. He's a troublemaker. And he ended up getting into trouble in Salem. Not very much, but enough that Boston made offers to Salem, and Salem ended up putting pressure on Roger to leave, which he did. And Roger went to the only other English settlement possible. He went down to Plymouth, where he became the assistant to the minister there. Now Roger sees a blank slate, because these people at Plymouth are not part of a royal charter. They actually had made their own compact about what they're going to be doing, how they're going to be running their settlement. And they are working under the Plymouth Company, which is sending product back to pay off their passage across. So Roger feels he's got a little bit of a free rein. And he starts preaching some things that sound really strange to the rest of the people there. One of them was, a minister should not be paid. When you pay a minister, that makes him a mercenary. He's doing it for the money. He's not just another member of the society working hard, making a living, and preaching in addition to that. Roger, being a city boy from London, was not a farmer, was not a fisherman. He certainly wasn't a hunter, but he did know trade. So what Roger did was he took English goods and he went out among the Wampanoag and the Narragansett, met with the people, learned their language, and started trading with them. I don't know if you know more than one language or not, but when you learn another language, it's not just word substitution. You end up learning that people with different languages actually see the world a little bit differently. Here's a perfect example. In English, we have something called a sheet of paper. And that concept of a sheet is something that brings an image to your mind. There's a sheet of glass. There's a sheet of ice. There's the sheet on top of the bed. It's a large, flat, smooth surface that covers something else. In French, the word for that thing, that sheet of paper, is une feuille de papier, a leaf of paper. The entire set of images that go along with that very thing are now different. A leaf falls from the trees. They can stack leaves. They're light. They're flexible. It's a different way of looking at the world. Roger, by trading with the native people, by learning their language, by learning about their culture, learned how they lived around here. And this becomes very important in a little bit. Roger got himself into even more trouble in Plymouth, and he went back up to Salem. He worked for Mr. Skelton, the minister there, for a while. Finally, Skelton dies, and Roger is invited to take his place as the minister in Salem. Many of the magistrates and the elders in Boston advised the church in Salem not to do this, but Roger accepted it and became the minister there. About this same time, the magistrates in Boston enacted a law requiring every man to attend worship and to contribute to the support of the church. Williams denounced this as a violation of natural rights. No one, he said, should be bound to maintain a worship against his own consent. Roger is preaching these dangerous ideas in church. The people are getting riled up. Boston is getting upset. Roger is disrupting everything in the society. A minister shouldn't be paid. The Indians own the land. If you want to live here, you've got to trade. You've got to make some sort of a deal with them. That's one of the things he learned from them, that this was all the Native Americans' land. If you want to live here, make some sort of a deal with them for it. In 1635, Williams was brought before the general court in Boston and accused of teaching that the magistrate ought not to punish a breach of the first table, except when civil peace should be endangered, the first table of the Ten Commandments. If you look at images of the Ten Commandments, there's the first one is, I am the Lord your God. The second one is, make yourself no graven image. The third is, don't take the Lord's name in vain. And the fourth is, remember to keep the Sabbath. Those are the ones, the only ones, that the state has no control over. The last six, honor your father and your mother, don't commit murder, don't commit adultery, don't steal, don't be a false witness, and don't covet your neighbor's goods. That is what the government on this earth is to take care of. They also charged Roger that he said that an oath ought not to be tendered to an unregenerate man. You had to swear by God that you would be a good citizen. And if the person taking the oath has not been saved, is not, and that's what unregenerate man means, is not really a member of the church, truly has had a conversion experience and understands everything. That man, if he is not someone that understands all of this, he's violating one of the first four commandments. Roger was also charged that said that a man ought not to pray with the unregenerate, even though he be with his wife or child. And that a man ought not to give thanks after the sacrament, nor after meat. These were really disruptive to the way that things were going on in there, in Boston. Now, according to a statement made by Williams himself, Governor Hayes gave this for the reason of the actions of the court. Mr. Williams holds forth these four particulars. First, that we have not our land by patent from the king, but that the natives are the true owners of it. And that we ought to repent of such receiving it by patent. Basically, the king has given the land to the English. Secondly, that it is not lawful to call a wicked person to swear, to pray, as being actions of God's worship. If you call someone to take that oath, and they're not a good person, and they take the oath by saying God's name is an act of prayer. So therefore, you're forcing that person to sin. Thirdly, that it is not lawful to hear any of the ministers of the parish assemblies in England. All they had done to get away from that, coming across the ocean to this place, why would you do that if you're just going to go back into the system? And fourthly, that the civil magistrate's power extends only to the bodies and goods and outward states of men. The government, basically, that's the government has the right to control what you do, but not what you think or what you believe. Roger continued to be disruptive. In talking about those patents, he says that Christian kings, so-called, are invested with right by virtue of their Christianity and take and give away the lands and countries of other men. This so affected Roger that Roger started writing letters back to England, including to the king, telling them that the king was sinning by giving away this land over here that belonged to the Native Americans. Totally disruptive to the society here. And he was offered a chance to recant, to say that he didn't believe in these things. But Roger wouldn't. He defended sending those. So in October of 1635, this was the sentence passed on Roger. Whereas Mr. Roger Williams, one of the elders of the Church of Salem, hath broached and divulged new and dangerous opinions against the authority of the magistrates, has also writ letters of defamation, both of the magistrates and churches here, and that before any conviction and yet maintaineth the same without retraction, it is therefore ordered that the said Mr. Williams shall depart out of this jurisdiction within 6 weeks now ensuing. And if he neglect to perform, it shall be lawful for the governor and two of the magistrates to send him to some place out of this jurisdiction, not to return any more without license from the court. Roger is now being kicked out. But when this order is issued, Roger is sick. And they know that going out in October to somewhere else, probably being sent back to England, an ocean crossing when you're already sick would kill him. So they let him stay in Salem until the springtime. They figured they let him stay there, the weather will be better, he'll be better, and then he can go back to England. And then he'll have to face the music there, whatever that is. Roger agreed, there was a condition. The condition was he not teach any of his dangerous opinions in church. Roger agreed to this. And he didn't preach his dangerous opinions in church. What he did do is talk about his dangerous opinions at the kitchen table after Sunday services. Pretty soon his house was more crowded than the churches were. The magistrates in Boston saw this and were entirely upset. And in January of 1636, sent soldiers from Boston up to Salem to arrest Roger and put him on the next ship back to England. Roger was warned ahead of time and escaped into the wilderness. January, in New England. A January like most people have never seen. Now remember, Roger's an English person. If it snows in England, it's a little dusting of snow. If it gets cold in England, it rarely goes below 25. There are palm trees in England. Here we're talking cold at an unprecedented level, even for New England. Hip-deep snow, Narragansett Bay frozen entirely over, and Roger Williams on foot sets out from England in what basically is a trackless wilderness for him. It's covered with fresh snow. If you take that shovel and you try to clear the driveway, you're going to miss the edges. You're going to go off track and you're going to get that patch of dirt coming up on the side and fly it up on top of the snow. Now imagine trying to walk 50, 75 miles to someplace that you don't know, following Indian trails that are now completely covered with snow. Roger nearly froze to death, was found by the Native Americans, taken in, given a place to stay until the springtime. Now, you may be asking, were these people in Boston that unstable, that fearful of their position, that just a few ideas could be that disruptive that they had to throw Roger out? Somebody that they had called friend and a goodly minister. Well, as with most things, there's more than just that to the story. It was a fellow at court, a friend of King James I, and a friend of his son, called Sir Fernando Gorges. And he was one of, if not the lead proprietor, to the Council for New England, which basically had the development rights to most of New England. There were other affairs that took his attention in 1627, and in 1628, a charter was granted to the New England Company. That's for the Massachusetts Bay. The company received a royal charter, and now Gorges, Sir Fernando Gorges, and the New England Company, or the Council for New England, and the Massachusetts Bay Company are arguing over the same piece of land. All the while, Roger is in Boston and Salem in the Massachusetts Bay Colony, preaching his dangerous opinions. Fernando Gorges and others in the Council for New England are trying to get the royal charter revoked. And what's Roger doing in the middle of it? He's challenging the magistrates and the elders in Boston. And it looks to people in England that want to get the Mass Bay Charter revoked, that the people in charge there can't control the people there. Sir Fernando Gorges wants to change this from a settlement colony to a company colony. He wants to make a profit off of this land. New England had vast resources that they could have used. And he's fighting tooth and nail at court to get the Mass Bay Colony charter revoked. People in Massachusetts Bay are falling in line. When they go back to England, they go to the Church of England because they don't want their charter revoked. They go to the Church of England and not to other services because who's the head of the Church of England? The king. And if they displease the king, that gives more power to the Council for New England and Fernando Gorges, and they just might lose their charter. So Roger's literally sitting in the middle of these two very powerful forces struggling over land in New England and doesn't shut up. Eventually, Sir Fernando Gorges ends up losing out on all of this competition and the Massachusetts Bay Colony keeps its charter. But this is the struggle that's going on as Roger is causing all of this trouble. Now Roger has left. Massachusetts Bay can try and stabilize their colony again without the disruption of these religious fringe groups, except a few that keep popping up strangely enough. But after a very rough winter, an interesting spring where he has to move again from East Providence to the place where Providence is today. After a year there, the settlers say, we need some sort of a document to pull us together because we may have a you may have a deal with the Native Americans, with the Narragansett for this land. But that's it. We don't have any legal documentation on how we're going to run ourselves. The people that live in this town put together what's called the Providence Agreement in 1637. And you should listen to this because it's really good. We, whose names are hereunder, desirous to inhabit in the town of Providence, do promise to subject ourselves in active and passive obedience to all such orders or agreements as shall be made for the public good of the body in an orderly way by the major consent of present inhabitants, masters of families, incorporated together into a town fellowship, and others whom they may admit unto them, only in civil things. You notice something that's lacking there? Well, let me point it out by taking a look at another group that did something similar. Those pilgrims that landed at Plymouth, when they realized where they were not in the northern parts of Virginia as their charter had told them, that they were north in the New England area. Before they set foot on land, they put together the Mayflower Compact on how they were going to run their own settlement because their charter might not be legal here. Let me read you just a little bit from the Mayflower Compact, right at the beginning. In the name of God, amen. We whose names are underwritten, the loyal subjects of our dread sovereign, Lord King James, by the grace of God of Great Britain, France, and Ireland, King, defender of the faith, etc., having undertaken for the glory of God an advancement of the Christian faith and honor of our king and country, a voyage to plant the first colony in the northern parts of Virginia, do by these presents solemnly and mutually in the presence of God and one of another, covenant and combined ourselves together in a civil body politic. These are basically the same kind of documents, agreeing that they're going to be a political entity. A town fellowship, a company incorporated together in a town fellowship for Providence, and in Plymouth, combine ourselves together in a civil body politic. The huge difference is, in Providence, there is no mention of God in any of it. I read you the whole thing. And it's only going to be making rules only in civil things. That is off the charts radical at this time. There are going to be no religious rules in this settlement. In the Massachusetts Bay, you had to be a member of the church to be able to vote. Here, the only rules are masters of families. Radical. Eventually, you end up with four settlements that became Rhode Island, but they did not have documentation from England. They made agreements with the native peoples, but you have Plymouth to the east, Massachusetts Bay to the northeast, and now a new colony, Connecticut, to the west. They all wanted part of Narragansett Bay. Why? Well, trade. If you lived in any of the Connecticut colonies and wanted to trade elsewhere, you have a problem. In the age of sail, you've got this big thing called Long Island stopping you from going anywhere. If you want to get to the southern colonies where a lot of goods are, a lot of money is, you have to either go to New Amsterdam to the west or almost to the entrance of Narragansett Bay to the east to be able to go south. If you're in the Massachusetts Bay Colony, if you're in Plymouth, if you're in Salem, and you want to go to those same southern colonies, you have to sail outside the Cape, outside the islands, outside the shoals, and then you have to buck the Gulf Stream to go south. Perfect example is even today, sailing. Newport to Bermuda is 3 to 4 days. Boston to Bermuda is 7 to 10 days. And to get back to Rhode Island, you just ride the Gulf Stream right back up and hit Narragansett Bay. It's in the perfect spot to trade with the other colonies, to trade with the Caribbean, to trade with where money is. With no legal documentation, Massachusetts Bay, a legal colony, Plymouth, a legal colony, Connecticut, becoming a legal colony, they could all take pieces of it away. So Roger made 2 trips back to England, the first in the 1640s and the second in the 1650s, to get documentation, legal documentation for this colony. In the 1640s, Roger gets a patent from Parliament defining what the colony is and how it's structured, guaranteeing the religious freedom that they had here. But while Roger's there, he ends up writing a book. Well, a couple of books. One of them, The Key to the Language, so that he would not forget the language of the native peoples that he had learned, but it becomes a bestseller. He becomes a minor celebrity in London. The second book that he writes, it's called The Bloody Tenet of Persecution. It is a dialogue in between truth and peace. What happened was John Cotton from the Massachusetts Bay wrote Roger a letter arguing why government and religion have to be bound together. Roger dissects the letter and turns it into this dialogue in between truth and peace. 2 very short pieces from that that really show Roger's point of view. God requireth not a uniformity of religion to be enacted and enforced in any civil state, which enforced uniformity sooner or later is the greatest occasion of civil war, ravishing of consciences, persecution of Jesus Christ in his servants, and of the hypocrisy and destruction of millions of souls. Well, if you don't have religion and government together, how does government work? Well, Roger explains that. The sovereign, original, and foundation of civil power lies in the people. And if that's true, a people may erect and establish what form of government seems to them most meet for their civil condition. Such governments as are by them erected and established have no more power, nor for no longer time than the civil power or people consenting and agreeing shall be trust them with. To me, this sounds an awful lot like somebody that was famous well over 100 years after Roger Williams dies. A guy by the name of Thomas Jefferson. In his one of the scrap pieces of paper he wrote called The Declaration of Independence, uses this kind of argument for why they are they're dissolving the bonds that tie England and the Americas together. But Roger's radicalness doesn't stop there. Roger had a huge influence on the charter we finally got from the king in 1663. That charter says that no person within said colony at any time hereafter shall be anywise molested, punished, disquieted, or called in question for any differences in opinion in matters of religion that do not actually disturb civil peace of our said colony. Listen to this. It's not no man. No person can be punished for what they believe. Totally radical. Further on in the charter, it says that Rhode Island gets to elect its own General Assembly, gets to elect its own governor. Most of the colonies had a royal governor, a friend of the king that was appointed to run things in that colony for a while, stuff his pockets full of cash, and then go back to England and enjoy himself. Rhode Island, a colony of about 1,500 people, out of that 1,500 gets to choose their governor and the people that are going to represent them. They're right down the street. They're those houses right over there. Basically, we're an independent functioning government underneath the king's jurisdiction. This is absolutely radical. So much so that 100 years after Roger dies, those ideas, like I said, picked up by Jefferson, when they're putting a new rule book for this country together, the idea that the sovereign original foundation of civil power lies in the people are translated into the first three words of the Constitution. It doesn't start off with Congress, by the grace of God, grants the American people these things. Three words, written 10 times bigger than anything else in the document. Bold, proud, capital letters. We, the people, are going to tell the government what it can and cannot do. All harkens back right here to Roger Williams. And those were radical ideas 100 years later. But they were first put into practice because of what Roger Williams did right here. Now, how important is this? Roger saw the potential of people getting lazy. Just a couple of years before Roger died, he wrote to the town of Providence. Basically, I'll read it to you. "I have only one motion and petition, which I earnestly pray the town to lay to heart, as ever they look for a blessing from God on the town, on your families, on your corn and cattle, and your children after you. It is this, that after you have got over some black brook of some foul bondage yourselves, you tear not down that bridge after you by leaving no small pittance for distressed souls that may come after you." It's Roger Williams to the town of Providence in 1679. Roger disrupted that great chain of being. Roger put together a government that worked with a complete separation of church and state, where the people were the foundation of power. So once again, I'm going to ask you, what do you call someone that wants to disrupt the functioning of your government and calls for its present form to be dismantled, wants to abandon the very framework that society is built upon, that points out religious hypocrisy in all its forms, who wants to create a new type of society that gives political power to those that have never had it before, recognizes the right of people to believe what they want to believe, and also recognizes those same rights of an apparently hostile potential enemy people, and wants to deal and treat with them as if they were equals? What do you call that someone? I'm going to call him Roger Williams. Thank you, folks.
Sorry, it's taken me a bit to get back in here. That was wonderful. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
If folks have questions, there's so many people in the audience, it's best if you write in the chat. So there is a question already, if you're ready for that.
Sure.
So how did others even know where Roger went when he was banished, if he was living with the Native Americans? When did others start coming to join him, and how many were there? This is one person asking this.
Sure.
What happened to Roger's family during this entire time? And so cool to learn how Rhode Island was the model of the fledgling U.S.
And also, before you answer that, John,
do you
a
want
lot
me to
of-
start with the first one?
And John, just so you know, a lot of people are saying thank you and an amazing job. Just so I know, we were talking a little bit about getting feedback from the room. So
excellent. Thank you. So the question, how did people know where Roger was? How many people joined him? When did they join him? All of those things. New England's pretty small. There was not an isolation in between Native peoples and English at this time. Word travels fast. The fact that Roger Williams was taken in by the people that we call the Wampanoag, everybody knew that. The fact that Roger Williams started a place in what was then called Seekonk, but is now East Providence, that came pretty, that word got around pretty quick. Roger would have sent letters to people, have Indian runners get it to Boston, maybe to Plymouth, to let his know his wife, to let his wife know that he's fine. People came down in the spring as soon as the weather changed and started building houses and started planting their crops in the East Providence settlement. How many? It's difficult to tell. Maybe five or six families at first. But Roger got a letter from the governor at Plymouth saying that he's in the wrong spot. He's still within the bounds of their colony. That's when he moved to the place along the Meshassic River and the Great Salt Cove. And the first families there's not a lot of people here. Even towards the end of the century, there's not a lot of people living in Rhode Island compared to some of the other colonies. For example, the beginning of King Philip's War, the English made up 10% of the population of Rhode Island. Only 10%. So, I mean, that's part of the reason we have so many Native American place names, and they maintained it because the English were still calling them that because that's where the Native American people lived. Did I touch everything on that question?
I think so.
Yes, I believe so. Okay. Sorry, you've gotten a lot of accolades and a few more questions have come in. So I'm scrolling back to the original one.
Sure.
Yes, I think so. Yep.
Okay.
Someone wants to know which room you're in right now and what's the splotch behind you. I was actually wondering the same thing, so I'll go ahead and ask it too.
I am in my virtual living room. It being a room that's made out of wattle and daub and whitewashed on the inside, every once in a while you get a leak, something happens, something shifts, and sometimes the water will leak down and cause a little stain on the wall.
And then did Roger Williams have any connection with Anne Hutchinson?
Yes. As I said, there were other troublemakers that were up there in Boston. I don't know that you could call them friends, but they were both being disruptive at about the same time. And when Anne Hutchinson and others ended up leaving Boston, they met with Roger, and Roger helped negotiate for the land that became Portsmouth. Negotiate with the native peoples for the land that became Portsmouth. Mm-hmm. So they at least had passing contact. They probably had some interesting debates. But the last contact in between Roger Williams and Anne Hutchinson wasn't necessarily a direct contact. When Roger left for his first trip back to England, there were no big ships coming into Narragansett Bay to take Roger away. He had to walk to New Amsterdam, mm-hmm. got on a Dutch ship to go back to England. And as he's leaving New Amsterdam or New York, it was New Amsterdam then, he sees fires in the distance, which happened to be Anne Hutchinson. One of them at least happened to be Anne Hutchinson's house being burned down. She had just been killed in an uprising. Wow. So as Roger's leaving on his first trip back to England, that's the last connection to Anne Hutchinson.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
Generally, you can't write this stuff in a script. I mean, this is just like, I mean, it's got all the right connections.
Yeah. Yeah, this is like almost like movie connections and how this really plays out. Well, I have the next question for you. And this is something that I was wondering too, actually. So it seems that Roger Williams does not get as much credit as nationally as he deserves, as you mentioned, as Thomas Jefferson. Why do you think that is?
Rhode Island is really small.
Yes.
Places with big populations get to write the textbooks. And if you compare all of Rhode Island to just the general area around Boston, they've got five times the number of people that we have. When Plymouth became really important, I mean, everybody celebrates Thanksgiving. It's not the first settlement. Why did Plymouth become important? Well, Thanksgiving was first proclaimed under Abraham Lincoln during the Civil War as a chance to give thanks for the little things that we have and also to pray for those that have been, their families, their lives have been disrupted by the war. Why was Jamestown left out? During the Civil War, that was in a different country. So they went to the earliest place, Plymouth. And now Plymouth gets all the hullabaloo about being the first place for this, the first place for that, where it's not the first. I remember in my elementary school books, it was about a paragraph about Jamestown, and then the next chapter went on about Plymouth. So the stories that you're told in school aren't necessarily the real history. They are quite often a way to create a nice national myth that mm-hmm. people can believe in. What Roger Williams did here affects the entire world. There's a gallery of statues in Geneva called the Heroes of the Reformation. And the person representing North America is Roger Williams in this gallery of statues. So he's recognized in certain places. But what he did was, like I said, this is dangerous. This is radical. Disrupt government, break up its form. Do you really want to celebrate somebody that wants to do that?
I have a question. How did he maintain a family with such a tough environment in early Rhode Island?
His family was tough. I don't usually do this, but if you want to find out how tough his family was, there's a program that we're going to be having next Thursday night at this time at 6:30. Roger Williams had a wife. Dr. Carrington Farmer from Roger Williams University is going to be presenting Roger Williams Had a Wife. Go to the Roger Williams National Memorial's Facebook page. Take a look. You'll see the information there. Sign up for that talk. These people were tough. Roger, when he goes away, he doesn't go away for 2 or 3 months. He goes away for years. And Mary, his wife, now has to run the entire household. She has to make the deals. There's an image in a book called Good Wives that talks about families back then being very much set up like a business, where the husband is the chief executive officer. He makes executive decisions. And the wife is the chief operating officer. She makes sure things work. And of course, children are labor. When the husband is away for an extended period of time, the chief operating officer gets to make those executive decisions. And that's what would have happened.
Let's see. I have read that Roger Williams had two very formative experiences in England before he came to America. One of them was that he was young. When he was young, that he was described as a spiritual experience, and the other was the execution of a family friend while he watched helplessly through a window. Could you possibly elaborate on those points?
I'm really not familiar with those. Very little is known about young Roger growing up. We knew he grew up in London. We know the street that he lived on, Cow Lane. His mother ran a tavern across the street from the residence. Roger's father was a merchant tailor. That's not somebody that makes suits. The merchant tailor class, there's still the merchant tailor guild in London. They're the ones that make the bespoke suits for the people with power. That's Roger's introduction to people at court, is through the customers of his father. Roger became Roger's mentor was the Chief Justice of England, Sir Edward Coke. So a lot of Roger's formative years are at Charterhouse School and in London. Exactly about these two incidents, he would have seen it. Trying to think if he could have. When he was very young, there would have been an execution in Smithfield was about 200 yards away from where he lived. And Smithfield was the place of execution for religious heretics. So it's possible he saw someone burned to death there for religious heresy. It was also the cattle market, hence Cow Lane going up to it. But looking out a window, it's 200 yards away. People were almost required to go to these executions, to be witness to what happens when somebody breaks God's law. And being burned at the stake wasn't something that was done in 15 minutes. when you read the original descriptions of it, it's just absolutely far more horrible than anything you could imagine.
I can imagine that would be quite a mark that's left on a young person in particular. Let's see. I have a couple more questions, if you don't mind.
No, absolutely.
Let's see. Did Roger Williams influence William Penn?
If so, very circuitously. Roger would have known William Penn's father, who was a general. I believe there was some connection with him when Roger was back in England in the 1650s with William Penn's father. But William Penn was a Quaker. Roger did not like the Quakers. Roger wrote a whole book about why the Quakers are wrong. When George Fox came to Newport to help establish the Quaker congregation there, Roger thought this is the perfect opportunity to prove him wrong, to go and debate him in public. But by the time Roger got down there, George Fox left. But he still spent 3 days arguing with the people there. An open debate. Came back and wrote, George Fox digged out of his burrows. It's a point by point argument about why the Quakers are wrong. So Roger may have had some influence on William Penn, but certainly not a direct line.
I know this is a short question, but a long answer. So I know you won't be able to answer it in full. If someone's asking about Roger Williams' experience during King Philip's War.
Let's start where I did just a little while ago. You have to understand, at the beginning of King Philip's War, in Massachusetts Bay, in Plymouth, even in Connecticut, the English are the dominant group. There's far more English than there are Native Americans. There's probably only a few hundred Wampanoag, the people underneath Philip, at this time. Yet in Rhode Island, the English make up 10% of the population. 1,500 English, at least 15,000 Narragansett. Philip and the Wampanoag have a problem with Plymouth. That turns into a fighting war, which basically starts out as guerrilla warfare. And Philip sends the old men, women, and children of the tribe to go stay with the Narragansett as refugees. Understand, boundaries in between tribes were much more fluid than they are in between European nations. Your cousin could be a Wampanoag. A Wampanoag's cousin could be a Narragansett. They're all family, they're all interrelated. These were not hard and fast boundaries marked by political and language divides. They all spoke basically the same language, not much different than Rhode Island versus Boston accent. So when these refugees are taken in by the Narragansett, they're bound by honor to protect them. Roger's an intermediary in between the Narragansett and the authorities in Boston. The authorities in Boston want the Narragansett to stay out of this war, let Plymouth deal with it. Fine, say the Narragansett. They agree and sign in October of 75 a neutrality treaty. They're going to stay out of this war. They don't want to have anything to do with it. Almost the exact same time that the delegation got back to Narragansett territory, Boston goes, oh, one more thing. We want you to turn over those Wampanoag refugees, turn them over to us as hostages. Remember, the Narragansett are honor bound to protect these people. They came in as refugees. They're honor bound to protect them. They said, no, they can't do that. Boston took this as a sign that basically the Narragansett were going to side with Philip in the springtime. So in December 1675, there was a preemptive strike of the United Colonies. United Colonies had kept Rhode Island out of everything. It's Connecticut, Massachusetts, and Plymouth. They invade Rhode Island and attack the Narragansett in the Great Swamp, killing about 700 men, women, and children. Canonchet, who was the war leader of the Narragansett, forms an army of about 2,000 Narragansett in southern Rhode Island. Goes up to central Massachusetts, forms another army of a couple of thousand natives up there near Mount Wachusett, and they start sweeping to wipe the English off the map. They start burning Rhode Island mainland settlements. Most of the people try to escape and get to Newport. It's on an island. It has a moat around it. Rhode Island had a Quaker governor at the time. Rhode Island did not field an army. There were many in Rhode Island of the Rhode Island settlers that sympathized with the United Colonies, gave them support, actually worked with them. But Rhode Island as a colony did not take part in King Philip's War. But now this army is marching up the west side of the bay, burning Wickford, burning Warwick, comes up and Roger confronts them in Providence. There's a wonderful letter that describes Roger's confrontation with these people. He starts scolding them. And they agree. They're in a strange place, as they say. He tries to bluff them. They call his bluff. Then he says, goes back to the diplomacy again and says, give me your demands. We'll write it down. We'll get a runner to get up this to Boston before anybody else has to die. And the leaders of this army that's in Providence says, talk to us in a month after we burn Plymouth. At the negotiations at the beginning of the war to try and find a peaceful resolution to things, some of Philip's people and some of the Narragansett were asking Roger, why are you involved in this? This is between Philip and Plymouth. And Roger explained, we're all English here. We're all subjects of one king. And after the Narragansett stronghold in the Great Swamp was devastated, 700 men, women, and children killed, when they were asked about why are they burning these English settlements in Rhode Island, you're all English. But they didn't harm Roger. Providence was burned in April of 1676. By August, the fighting was over. Native Americans were surrendering. There's very few people left in Providence. Native Americans are coming in and surrendering. Armies are marching around in the field because the fighting is still going on up in Maine. Groups of Native Americans trying to surrender are slaughtered by troops. They have paperwork in their hands saying they're non-combatants. Didn't matter. They were killed. So now, Providence has a huge number of Native American captives. What are you going to do with them? A lot of people, a lot of the English, wanted to just kill them. Everybody had lost everything. Native Americans had lost everything. English had lost everything. The English were so angry, they just wanted to just kill them all. You could probably let them go, but if you did, at least some of them are going to go up north where the fighting is still continuing. Or if you let them go, they go back out to try and go and start their homes up again. And some of these soldiers that are still marching around the landscape are going to kill them out there. The decision that they finally came to was that they were going to sell them into slavery down in the Caribbean. Is it a great decision? No. Most of the other decisions mean death. Some of these people were friends of Roger's. The only thing that it really shows is that in war, sometimes there are no good answers. How's that work?
Thank you for that that answer. I there's so much to ponder in that, in that last statement in particular. And yeah, you put it so beautifully. I'm looking at the clock right now. We have 7:38. So I think that's a great spot to end. Thank you so much, John. I so deeply appreciate this. Your talk was fantastic. People have been sending in accolades and thanks for how much you provided. So I'll take some notes on this and I'll send them your way, because I mean, people have really lovely things to say.
I want to thank everybody for coming and listening to me. I also want to thank you guys for having me here to be able to do this. This is a chance to talk to so many people in a single means. It's just absolutely fantastic. And you guys have provided me that opportunity. And I've got to thank you guys for that.
It's always a pleasure having you or working with you.
Yeah.
Thank you so anytime.
Much. John, can I ask you one quick question? Are you available for high schools?
Sure.
Okay, good to know. Robert Kimball.
Absolutely.
Robert Kimball, yes.
Doing it this way, absolutely.
That is great. For all the things that COVID has really shown us this year, it's that Zoom makes us really open and accessible and flexible to a much wider audience. So thank you so much for doing this, John. Thank you to everybody that signed on tonight. We're so happy. Oh, I'm seeing applause. Lovely.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, John.
Thank you all.
Bye, everyone.